Welcome to a show about things you can see without going far, and a lot of them are free. If you thought there was nothing in the old heartland, you ought to hit the blackop with these fools in a van. Look out, they're driving hard, checking out art in their own backyard. Randy does the steering so he won't hurl. Mike's got the map, such a man of the world. That's Don with the camera, kinda heavy on his shoulder. And that giant ball of tape, it's a world record holder. Look out, they're driving hard, checking out art in their own backyard. Look out, they're driving hard, checking out the world in their own backyard. Checking out the world in their own backyard.
Dear TV Mailbag, is this my second favorite state? Hi, Don the Camera Guy here, reading up on high def from a low-tech perch. Jammed in the back of a cramped Chrysler with two TV weasels up front calling the shots. Though with glass like that, I'm not sure how.
We're gonna clean that soon, but we got some stuff to go see. Right up here in a town called St. Joe.
Finding stuff is what we do. Grassroots art and off the beaten path wonders, not unlike this field of farm cast-offs just a few miles from town. Wind may be an issue.
So we got ladybugs, we got daffodils.
I think those are sunflowers. It's like a giant, that one piece out there is like a giant wishbone, and it does move in the wind.
You know, you've always got art critics, don't you? Some of them are tougher than others. Well, this is the kind of defense mechanism they've built up here to keep people at bay. I managed to skirt it, tiptoe through the poop fields. I like it. So remember when we went to Illinois and we saw the prairie mask? That was kind of a letdown.
Yeah.
But this is pretty good.
No, I like this.
I like this too. It's in St. Joe, Texas. It's just south of St. Joe, Texas, over by Munster.
No, nothing cheesy about it. And yes, on the way back through town, we did confirm that the run-and-end sculptor in residence recently passed and picked up a little something to add to our vehicular clutter. But after all, balls are a big part of this show. Ones made from videotape and smaller balls like the kind we toss around too. Now the glove I sometimes catch him with is called a Nakona, as is the best boy I reluctantly left behind. And when spelled with a C, the name of the town we're headed towards.
Ooh.
It's the home of the last American-made ball glove, and that's a thrill. So please bear with me while I quickly take the tour. Gawk a while in the gift shop.
Oh, look at all those beauties. Oh,
get the charge card out.
Even throw a few on the lawn with our gracious guide. Spring training indeed. Okay, that's better. Now on to Wichita Falls, which, despite its name, did not apparently have a falls until someone built one. And speaking of building, the town also claims to have the world's littlest skyscraper. Naturally, there's a story, and naturally, it involves a scam. We're about to hear more from Glenda, who sells antiques down at ground level.
An architect was here from Philadelphia, 1919-1920, but he went back home and he drew up plans to build a skyscraper. And he took the plans to different investors and told them the situation, that we had this big oil boom and we didn't have office space. They gave him $200,000 to come back here and build a skyscraper. What he failed to point out was that his scale for his drawing was based on inches versus feet. They said when he left, there wasn't even a staircase. He had built the brick facade and put in the windows and the floors, but you had to go by ladder. So, at some point, somebody did add the little staircase, and then sometime in the 1960s, somebody from here submitted that story to Ripley's, believe it or not, And they're the ones that came back and told us we could call it the world's littlest skyscraper. I don't think it's ever been used for anything but storage. It's just been always stuck back there. And you know, the other day a lady came in and she said, what was the man's name? I don't know. Nobody's ever asked me that question, to where I went back to look at it and retain it.
What was his name?
I've got it on an article, but I don't know it, so you're the second person now to ask me that question.
What was his name?
Yeah. Okay, third person.
Hard-hitting journalists that we are, we never did get that name, but did learn lots about the romantic Valentine's meal served upstairs. And in return for this taste of the smallest, served up some world's largest of our own.
Tell me.
Oh, yeah, it's real heavy.
And then return to the driving portion of this show. Driving deeper and deeper into West Texas, and deeper into what just might be the dumbest thing we've done yet. And that's saying a lot. Buddy, this bit's for you. If you knew Peggy Sue. I'm not sure which is scarier. White guys dancing or copyright lawyers on our tail. We can always plead insanity. Now, technically speaking, we're not in Lubbock anymore. This would be Ransom Canyon, a few miles away and topographically way more dramatic. As for drama, how about the steel house up on the ridge, the one Robert Bruno moved into this spring, the one he's been building all by himself since 1974.
Being there wasn't a whole lot to do in Lubbock at that time, I figured I needed some substantive hobby. Actually, when I first came, I started working on a fairly large sculpture and worked on it for the first year that I was here, and it was walking underneath that sculpture, which was large enough to walk under. It seemed like a nice environment, and I decided, well, maybe I could capture that same atmosphere at a little larger scale and have that be a home. And one thing that's a little bit different from conventional construction is that the shell is the structure. The outside skin is what holds it all up. It's not a frame with a sculpture draped over it. I started with some very general plans that explained that it would be on four legs and that the floor would be about this far off the ground. But beyond that, everything is a design as you go. This isn't really the product of 3 months of design and 33 years of construction. This is 33 years of design. And so what's here is quite different and much more elaborate than what I envisioned in the beginning.
Did you do all the welding yourself?
Mm-hmm. This would be a living room, or will be a living room, I should say. Right now it's sort of workroom. There'll be a library down here, and this goes part way into one of the legs, and so the floor space is quite small. This would be a dining room in here. And through that opening over on the side will be a kitchen. I really wanted that the house be a large sculpture that has been sort of divided up into usable spaces. And so I see some of the inside walls as just arbitrary partitions, and the same with the windows. You know, this isn't at the end of a wall or something, it's just an intersecting plane. At one time, this surface here ran up all the way to be a part of the support for the roof. I mean, there are just lots of things. These stubby things here at one time were, that one there was an arch that curved over all the way to over the staircase. In general, this has to meet all the same standards that a conventional house does. It's just that most of the time we think that those standards tell you what it looks like, but they don't. They just give you a level of safety. My structural elements don't just have to look like structural elements only. They can look like a lot of things.
You, I think, originally had a plan to move in a little earlier.
Mm-hmm. Somewhere in the 70s. Most people think, you know, you thought you'd be in 3 years, you took 33. You missed it by a lot. But the reason that I'm doing this is because I like doing it. And so to have pulled off spending 33 years doing what you want, I would say is a major success. And the difference between the day before I moved in and the day that I moved in was that somewhere midnight-ish, I didn't go somewhere else to sleep. The rest of the day was exactly the same.
Incredible as all this may be, it's even more amazing when you realize this. Robert's scared of heights. Oh, and he's also helped create this house across the street, which is a story in itself. But he's not living there, and we've used up our time in the canyon. Time to head south through more land where cotton is raised, and so was a blocker. Yep, Hoss himself, whose final resting place we've seen on the other side of the state, grew up here in O'Donnell. Which remembers him still with a striking piece of postmodern sculpture.
It's beautiful.
Made by Glenn Goodacre.
Does it really look like Dan? I guess a little.
I think it does.
Oh, I'm seeing him.
Yeah.
So, oh, my goodness.
That was a good show.
It was a good show.
Times were simpler then.
And O'Donnell was quite a bit busier. It wasn't long before our presence drew some attention. Harold ambled over from the museum to check out the lunchbox and swap a tale or two about that blocker boy. But one basic question did stump us all.
How old would he be?
69?
80?
Would he be 80?
I'll have to give you a handout if we got out that far.
Oh, we don't take no hand. Yes, we do. We're public TV.
We usually have our hand out.
80, by the way, is the correct answer. In honor of Dan's big 8-0, the boys pulled some quick community service.
Clean the joint up a little bit.
Yeah.
And with one 60s icon behind us, we soon found ourselves face to face with another, just down the way in La Mesa.
Rah, rah.
A genuine muffler jackie in cheerleader garb.
Weren't they all fiberglass? Or is that fiberglass? It's just me.
Check Jackie's footwear.
I mean, those are not the kind of shoes you cheer in.
Those look like Elton John's shoes.
Yeah, they do.
I think something's wrong here. Something's very wrong here.
Get back in the light and say that again.
I think something's very, very wrong here. Very, very wrong.
You've been watching Gone with the Wind lately?
Yeah. Flash, sir.
I have no idea what just happened, nor can I explain why this mutton-chopped matador is spearing the bull with a Cheeto. With La Mesa in the rear view, we sailed towards Snyder, not for the gold DeLorean in the bank lobby, we heard it's gone, but for another classic example of yard art with no discernible theme.
I don't know, I've never seen a spark plug swing before.
Someone's been busy, and though fatigue is setting in, we've got the pictures to prove it.
Got a big spur, that's kind of a cool little arch. Mr. Peanut himself. And of course, the proverbial
bad egg.
Last shot of the day.
The little hearts. There's a little love in that coffee pot.
How do you know that's not like a milk pitcher?
That's a coffee pot. Everybody
knows that.
Knows that except
pot.
For you.
Everybody see it say, woo!
Just shoot the coffee pot and let's drop that postcard.
Now, as a non-carnivore, I'd say that starting a day at a chicken farm leaves me kind of queasy. But I realize poultry's been replaced by art out here since the 1970s. This being Sunday, the complex is laying low, getting ready for the big ceramic show next week. In other words, for once we're early. So we poked around the premises and picked up some free stuff from Roger.
Thank you, sir.
Including some dubious directions to a promising sounding site nearby. A sight we'd seen in a book by Austin's Jill Noakes, which, truth be told, helped bring us here in the first place.
Well, it's right there. It's that one.
And here it is, too, thanks to the miracle of TV, keeping viewers like you from wandering around, doubling back, and coming up empty. Not that I'm saying we did.
Well, we found it, didn't we?
We did.
There's the owl up there.
And a couple of broken owls.
And a bowling ball thing.
And, you know, it's too bad people at home can't smell it.
Mr. Cadena doesn't seem to be at home, so I guess I could read a little bit out of the book for you, if that would help.
That would help.
The different decorative elements, travels as a migrant worker. He picked these things up while he was a migrant worker, some of this. This really is about his life.
Was he a singer?
It's just one of these places where someone wanted to make their place special. They wanted to add a little ornamentation. They talk a little bit about their past, maybe. I think they worked in the factories. If I'd read this book a little closer. It's cute, sweet, I like it.
Yeah, you know, I'm just happy to see arches without hamburger.
Speaking of which, there's some Mexican food around here.
Yeah.
Just a guess.
Now that's some producing I can get behind. We did indeed find food and soon found ourselves crisscrossing San Angelo, a town that seems to be overstocked with crazy stonework. Craig Kinney thinks so too. Though details are sketchy, his architect's eye has been caught by its idiosyncratic style.
Our theory is that there's a mason that traveled in between Austin and San Angelo, because I see them all along the highway between here and Austin. He did a lot of work here. Typical of this work is the rope joint that you'll see here, and it looks like there's rope in between the stones. To bring this many different stones out here must have been a chore. I mean, you have to go to each rock pile and bring them in. It's not like he just went to the local yard and got them. And so this is like a jigsaw puzzle of putting these pieces together just so, and finding this rock out of all the piles he has. You know, he chose this one to put right here. Most masons at this time and today would just smear that over and make that mortar.
I like the garage.
Somebody with a T, of course, originally owned the house, because you can see the T on both sons. The green mortar, I mean, you just really don't see that anywhere. I just love these big, bold slashes. And I love the window treatments here with the, you know, the funky white, whitish stone that's just so jig-jaggy. It's just a fabulous house. But look at that. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
And it's all just very geometric in there. Look at those funky stones that come out right at the top of the gable.
Yeah, I see those three that kind of stick out.
Like beehives, all these houses with this stone were not designed by architects, so it's a great example of folk art and a craftsman who really cared about what he did.
It was about this time that we unveiled our super secret Texas weapon. Houston's Larry Harris, architect, bon vivant, and keen-eyed observer as well.
That's a vintage 1928 satellite dish.
Good thing Larry is narrow. Packed in bag for yet another crosstown trip, this time to Bobby Piser's place.
Tuscan Garden.
Bobby's a cop-turned-gardener, turned-self-taught artist, and seldom at a loss for words.
I started art about 15, 20 years ago, maybe, after a wasted career in law enforcement.
Could you enforce that muffler law there?
I would love to. This right here is Yucca Bella. We can tell by there. This is Agave Ferris. Very winter hardy, very xeric in nature.
Xeric.
Without water. Xeriscape comes from xeric or xera in Greek. It means no water.
Are we going to be learning stuff here?
Yeah, nobody said there was going to be any learning
any
in this
Greek
show.
Sorry. And this is my version of the Olympic torch. That's a living, breathing agave up there, agave americana.
Giant asparagus?
No, it looks like a giant asparagus, but it's not. It's agave havardi.
What are these little guys?
Those are wild chicones.
Wild chicones?
Chicones.
So you were always kind of doing
interested
that?
Interested in plants, yes.
Plants, but not so much the metal stuff?
No, no. I just got into metal about 2 years ago. I had some gates built, and I thought, well, I can do that, so I bought a welder. I figured I can do anything except sing, dance, and make money.
Are you a history buff?
No, no. I saw a photograph in a magazine, and I thought it was the prettiest thing I'd ever seen, so I did it.
It's more Latin.
El post nubile phoebus means after the cloud sunshine. And the next one, honk if you speak Latin. Cogito, ergo sum, I think, therefore I exist. And the last one, I can't hear you, I have a banana in my ear. This is the Tuscan garden. Initially it was a Mediterranean garden, but Tuscan is easier to say than Mediterranean, so.
You carve this yourself?
Yes, sir. That's my nautilus shell.
Yeah.
This tree was just planted last year. When it gets up to here, I'll prune it and trim it and train all the branches to cascade out. There's some very, very extremely rare rock cactus. Seldom seen blooming like this.
Yeah.
In fact, just almost never. I give not a whole lot of thought to where I put things. Most of the time, I just wake up and do it, and then if it's wrong, I live with it. If it's right, well, I take a great deal of pride in it. I build things, and I can drive around town and see them and know that I've left something, because I'm leaving someday.
Really?
Really.
Where are you going?
One place we know he's headed is down the aisle. Wedding the woman he swears helped make him less crusty. We'd wish him well in Greek or Latin if we knew how, but Spanish is what we really need now. For the last stop of this show at Jesus Zertuche's.
Muy bueno.
Muy bueno, okay.
His place is amazing, but as you'll soon see, our language skills are not.
Might be.
Mucho. Trabajando
aquí, see? I work for my job, but when I have a little time, he work here. Saturday or Sunday. I finished this in Waterfall in 3 months, between in March, April, and May. For July 4th, it's ready.
What do you call it?
Cascada, Piedra, Pinta.
Oh, Cascada, Piedra,
Pinta. Piedra, Pinta. In English, it's waterfall, painted rock.
Painted rock waterfall.
Yeah, painted rock
waterfall. Si. ¿Qué es eso?
Es a snake. Es una, anaconda.
Anaconda?
Anaconda, yeah. It have a 17 feet long.
17 feet long?
Yeah.
And un rojo snake?
Oh, no, it's dragon.
Dragon?
Dragon. Oh. You have a horn.
Pardon, pardon.
You have a horn.
Dragon, si, yeah, si. Oh, dragon, sorry.
You're doing good, Mike. That's,
un panther?
Yeah.
So do you say in Espanol panther?
Pantera.
Pantera?
Yeah.
Do you swim in the pool? Swim?
not much deep.
Music, they say, is the universal language, and Jesus must be a believer. He's written some 400 songs, including this one, inspired, he says, by the waterfall.
Dios me ha concedido hacer esta cascada. Él hizo que en el desierto saliera el agua clara.
After the serenade, our troubadour traded hats and proceeded to show us just how much vigor a 75-year-old can have.
One small step for Jesus.
What can I say except adios from San Angelo? This is Don the Camera Guy, signing off.
D DVDs, T-shirts, and a companion book for this series are available by calling 1-800-459-9733. To learn more about the sites and artists featured on this episode, and to get more information about the show, go to rarevisionsroadtrip.com.
There's your water tower.
Oh. Cleanliness next to godliness.
I'll put the first muffins in the new trash can.
Yeah, hey. Guys like muffins? They were homemade.
Not much.
No thanks. I've had too many.
Follow them in. It's three.